Hello guys, how are you doing? This is Rob of Rule of Two Review. Welcome back to the channel. And today we need to discuss some of the fallout from a pretty big scandal that happened a couple of days ago, revolving around E3. So it's been pretty busy in the E3 news circuit the past couple of days. I'm sure that most of you guys are familiar with this, but I'm going to touch on some of the details a little bit here before I get into the real meat of the video and the actual topic itself. We're following up a little bit on what happened with E3, or really the ESA, which is kind of the organization behind E3, the annual gaming convention that, of course, we all know and love. The big problem here is that on the website for E3, the ESA's website for E3, it was noticed that a lot of public information for a lot of attendees for this past E3 was made visible and public. We're talking over 2,000 different personalities. Mostly big name figures in the video game industry and in the journalism side of gaming, some YouTubers and whatnot. Pretty big deal. And this is some serious personal information. I mean, telephone numbers, email addresses, home addresses. In a lot of ways, some of the scarier stuff out there that you don't really want available was made available. And again, these are mostly public figures. And the more notoriety behind an individual, the more celebrity, you could say, the more potentially dangerous it is to have some of that information out there. So of course, the industry, a lot of people, gamers, and fellow YouTubers and industry critics have all reacted to this, and it's a pretty bad situation. Really what we're looking at is effectively the doxing of 2,000 people within the industry. That's the most simplest term, the most simplest form of what we're looking at here. Very potentially dangerous. And according to Kotaku's report on this, it sounds like there's been a few people who've already had some unwanted contact due to this, which is what you really don't want to see happen. It's kind of the worst case scenario when you think about it, is my public information got out there and I never wanted it to. Oh my gosh, what do I do? And now suddenly people are contacting me and I don't want them to be. This is awkward and uncomfortable. And for some people could even be very much really scary. So this whole thing is bad news, and E3 as an organization and the ESA is dealing with a lot right now, including a potential class action lawsuit. There is some organization happening right now to go after the ESA for this, for violating privacy and basically creating this huge mistake. They have essentially owned up to it as a mistake. They released a public statement that essentially said, we came to realize that there was this mistaken access to this information on our website, on our portal, I think they called it. We're sorry, we took it down, we corrected it, what have you. But even that has garnered some criticism. Some people have even criticized how they handled it once they were made aware of the issue. So the whole thing is very messy, and you look at the class action lawsuit and you consider some of the downward trajectory, you could say, of E3 over the years in terms of attendance from certain companies, as well as from industry attendance, and then the fact that they had to open up E3 to some of the public for a lot of money per ticket. And so that has really just kind of shown that some of the interest and the success and the overall delivery and quality of E3 has been suffering. And now this is both bad PR and potentially millions of dollars they may be paying in restitution to this lawsuit. So basically, it's like World War III for E3 right now, as far as what they're dealing with. And it's definitely a shame, and I have a lot of thoughts on all of this. One of the real big thoughts that I do have from all of this actually has to do with whether or not E3 is even going to last. I want to give full credit to a fellow friend and YouTuber who you guys obviously know, Dreamcast Guy. He actually posted a video earlier this morning talking about if this leak, this doxing scandal, is going to end up basically ending E3 in some way, shape, or form. And it's a great video. You should definitely watch it and hear what he has to say. He makes a lot of really interesting points. I very much enjoyed watching it. And the topic and conversation he had inspired kind of a similar topic in my brain. And that's what I want to talk about. So I did want to give him credit for that and shout out his video. He's a trillion times bigger than me, so you've probably even already seen the video. But either way, I'm going to link it below, and I want you guys to know that his conversation sparked this in me. When we look at the idea of E3 ending because of all of this, it's a sad thing. No one wants E3 to end, I don't think, but I do think it is honestly a realistic situation we need to consider. At first, it might seem like just like an overzealous headline for the sake of clicks or for the sake of inciting fear, when really maybe the organization is too big to be ended by something like this. I could see how somebody might think that initially, but I actually, the more I look at this and the more I consider where things have been going and now what's happening here, I don't think it's a crazy thought to think that this could be one of the final nails in the coffin that could eventually lead to E3's downfall. Now, keep in mind, I in no way, shape, or form want this to happen. I absolutely love that E3 happens every year. We all as an industry and as a gaming community come together every year to celebrate it, to watch it, to live stream it, to react to it, to discuss it, and to just be excited about the things that we learn about and see at E3. It's been part of my life as a gamer for the past 20 years or whatever, since it became a little bit more known to the public back in the late CES days before it then broke off and actually became its own thing as E3. I was a teenager, early 20s whenever that happened, and it was exciting, and I've been following it ever since, you know, even before the internet really made it possible to be up to date with everything up to the minute. I remember just waiting for magazines to read about what happened at E3. There was no live streams for sure, and even before the live streams happened, you know, you would have to go to a website like IGN back in the day and find their replay of the conferences and just go there for articles about what was shown. And it's just been a part of my life for a really long time, and I'm sure for most of you guys as well. We're so used to having E3. And so I and most people don't want E3 to go away. But, you know, I've already kind of hinted at this. We've already seen a struggling trajectory for E3 throughout the past probably 5, 6 or some odd years anyway. And when you see this being such bad PR, and then you consider how much money they may be paying back due to this lawsuit, if that whole thing plays out, you know, in the positive for the people affected and in the negative for E3, it is potentially very damning. My own personal history here, some of you guys might have heard me say this. I did attend E3 way back in 2004, and that was a different time for E3. I do think it's one of the best E3s that there ever has been. The industry was so strong, was really building up momentum in that sixth generation. So many incredible games were at E3 2004. I felt so lucky and blessed to go. And also, like I said, it was a different time for E3, so just the mere idea of attending E3 was that much more magical and that much more unimaginable for the average person. But at the time, I and a roommate were working for GameStop, so that was what allowed us to qualify to go for free. We only had to pay to get ourselves out there and stay in LA. We didn't have to pay to actually attend or get our badges for the show. My girlfriend at the time worked for Suncoast Video, for anyone who remembers that old store, and we were able to make that qualify too, as, you know, jobs at GameStop and Suncoast Video, like a DVD store, those were considered in the entertainment, retail, electronic media field. And so we qualified, and the three of us went. We made a road trip from Denver out to LA for the week, and it was absolutely incredible. It was a utopia, and it was basically a behind the scenes, behind the closed doors of E3 kind of experience. And even in 2004, there was a lot of internet coverage of E3, but it still wasn't as personal and up to date as it is now. And so at that time, being at E3 meant so much, and it felt so different and special. Nowadays, because of the waning success and interest in E3, they've opened up tickets to the public. And so that's, to me, a huge sign is when I went back in 2004, we didn't pay anything to attend. If you, as a non-industry person, non-media person, are attending E3 nowadays, you're paying, I don't know what the price is, $150 to $300 for a ticket. I don't know, but I know it's over $150. So you get thousands of people paying that much money. That's a whole lot of money going to E3's pocket, to the ESA's pocket, to help kind of fund the show, because it's obviously very expensive. But it also kind of makes it less interesting to me. The fact that people who aren't involved or don't get special access behind the scenes can go just because they pay the ESA a bunch of money, I think it's great for those people. Don't get me wrong. It's a great experience to have, but it kind of devalues what it means to attend E3 when it's just open to people to buy a ticket. It changes, in my opinion, the whole dynamic. And don't just take my word for it, because plenty of people in the industry who are used to going for different outlets over the years have since said that once it opened to the public, the feeling on the show floor of E3 is very different. And I can completely see why, having attended it long ago. And so already, in my opinion, obviously that means that we're seeing the lessening value of E3 and the lessening interest. The fact that they had to open it up to the public to keep people engaged and interested, the fact that they had to charge people so much money to do it so that they're making money back because they're obviously recouping costs that they're no longer otherwise making, And the fact that it just changes the whole PR perception of what it means to go to E3. These are all really not great things. And we've also seen companies pulling out in different ways. Nintendo still has a big presence, but they don't hold live press conferences anymore. Sony didn't even show up last year. EA and Microsoft have been pulling away from E3, and we're only going to see more and more companies probably do it throughout the next couple of years. And that's just not great. Now, if we take all of this and we focus this back onto the current issue with the doxing, the leaking of people's information and whatnot, very, very scary stuff. And like I said, I am honestly really glad that I didn't attend this past year. And since I've been doing Rule of Two Review and have a bit of a following and a reason to go and very easily, well, not easily, but very likely could qualify with some of my connections and the path that I know to take to be able to attend E3 as like a media and go for free, that means that there's a chance any of these years that I decide to go, that my name could have been on that list. And suddenly my home address, my house right now that I'm in, could be known to people. And that freaks me out. It really, really does. And most other YouTubers and industry people have said the same thing. It's a scary thought. So I already, from a personal sense, look at this whole thing and I get kind of creeped out because I'm just that much of a step closer than the average person to potentially having my information leaked, as well as plenty of other people and friends of mine and fellow YouTubers who I've gotten to know over the years. All of them are potentially at risk from something like this happening. So it's a huge boffed mistake from the ESA when we look at this whole thing. I'm not calling for their crucifixion. I'm willing to give a lot of companies and people in these things a pass. But I'm willing to give them like a do-over, or I'm willing to say, you made the mistake, you have to pay for that mistake, but otherwise you're fine. I don't want anything to happen to you. I want you to be able to continue. I'm willing to forgive you once we get over this hump. So I'm willing to forgive the ESA and E3 for this, but I do still think there's going to be some long-lasting effects. I think most people are terrified at the idea of going to E3 now. Most people who you could argue maybe matter to the E3 experience. The people who work for IGNs and Kinda Funny and GameSpot and Kotaku, Polygon, you know, bigger industry pundits, people like Michael Pachter and Greg Miller and so many others. I mean, I could just name a trillion people, you know, different people who work for all of these outlets. I feel like they're gonna be pretty nervous about the idea of attending E3 and wanting to be in contact with them. Because who trusts them now? Not many people, I'm sure. I don't think anyone really trusts that organization as far as getting themselves on board with attending. Directly next year. I don't mean over the course of the next few years. I mean 2020's E3. I think it's very much in danger. And not to mention this lawsuit, which I very likely think will have some traction and could potentially mean the ESA is going to pay out a lot of money back to people who were affected by this. That just means there's that much less money in the bank for the ESA to be comfortable as far as putting on a big show like E3. So for all of these reasons, I've spent longer than I meant to, but for all of these reasons, I do think E3 as a conference is in danger. I mean, even next year, like I said, even 2020's E3, but even if 2020's E3 still goes off, I think all of the following years are in danger and we might see a situation where eventually E3 just goes away. And so what would happen if we lived in a world where E3 went away? It's a sad thought, but I overall think, and I think that most people wouldn't jump to this, but for me, I actually overall think we'd be okay. For a couple of years, there would be a pretty big void. There's no doubt. We'd all be like, man, it feels so strange without E3. We're so used to E3 around the June summer month time. This really is sad and it just sucks. There's no E3. But we have to look at how many other things are happening around E3. I think a show like Tokyo Game Show or GDC is probably going to get a big boost in attention, and I think that those could really help fill the void. They already do a little bit of that, but they've never felt quite the same. But if a lot of the industry and the developers and these companies and people move their attention to those two shows, suddenly we could boost the coverage and boost the level of interest and attendees to those shows, which would very much help. Wouldn't feel the same, but it would help. We also have Nintendo Directs every year. We get the Inside Xbox shows. Sony's doing their State of Play now. So these things would also help pick up the slack. And of course, the PlayStation experience could always come back. And so shows like that really, really can help. Microsoft has been doing something separate from E3, you know, like involved, but also separate at their own kind of a stadium there. They might devise something to fill the gap of E3. EA's been doing their EA Play thing, which we all hate and know is dumb, but if they continued that and maybe even improved it, that could also help fill the void of no E3. And so the point is, I think in a lot of ways, the industry would probably work pretty hard to pick up the slack and probably see it as an opportunity to kind of get some more attention on their individual shows that already are happening outside of E3. And maybe some companies would even devise new shows and new events outside of E3 that don't currently exist to help pick up that slack. So I think that that's probably what I would see happen. Now, if E3 did go away in the next year or maybe 2 or 3 years, there is also a chance it only goes away for a while and eventually would come back. Reorganized, rebranded, maybe even changing the name, who knows? I mean, who knows? It's hard to kind of picture that future, but there's always that chance that they really would just need to take a couple of years off because they've lost so much money, they've lost so much positive buzz and interest, the PR situation would be such a nightmare. Okay, 2019 screwed us, we tried in 2020, but it was a disaster, so we're going away for 4 years, but we're gonna come back strong once we've recouped whatever we need to recoup. You know, we'll come back then and kind of make a go at it. That could very likely happen as well. But I don't think that it would, like, kill the industry. I think that, you know, some people might want to initially react in a very scared way and in a very immediately negative way. Like, you know, we'd all be done if there's no E3. Oh, my gosh. And I just don't think that I would see that happening. It would be sad, as I've said several times. But I think overall, the industry would be able to bounce back well from it. And it would change the face of the industry in a lot of ways, I think, because E3 is so ingrained in the identity of the industry and how we're used to spending our year building up to E3 and then reacting to everything after E3 and how we're used to focusing our attention. And sometimes we try to predict and calculate what companies are going to do around the fact that we know E3 happens every year. But if E3 went away, it would suddenly change how we're perceiving the rest of the industry. And it would change how companies dole out their information just because they don't have this annual E3 week to look forward to every year anymore. So, you know, the face of the industry would change, but I don't think it would damage or, like, make the industry suddenly just go away or suffer too much. You know what I'm saying? I know people might want to think that, but I just don't see that being the fallout from losing E3. And so at the end of the day, I think that's really where my opinions kind of have to end, because we only have so much information to go on. This scandal is only a couple of days old. The fallout is only just getting going. I think we're going to hear a very quiet period for a while, but eventually we're going to get some news announced in the next couple of weeks or next couple of months as we see the ESA have to truly respond, because other than their one statement, they haven't responded. They've said nothing on Twitter, the E3 official page. And I actually suspect a little tomfoolery going on here, because I went to their more recent tweets and their pinned tweet on their Twitter page, and there is no mention in the comments in the subsequent tweets about any of this stuff. And that's not how these scandals usually happen, you know? Usually when a scandal happens with a person or a company or an organization, you can go to that page's Twitter and all of the most recent tweets, even if they have nothing to do with that scandal, everyone is talking about it. People flood that Twitter account to discuss it or maybe call them out or ask them for questions or whatever. I'm not going to name any recent ones, but you could think of a couple over the last year, and that happened. And I think it's interesting that, you know, there's a lot of people talking about this issue, but if you go to the Twitter page, it is silent. It's almost like they're deleting or blocking tweets. I don't even know if that's possible. I don't know. Maybe nothing's going on, but my conspiracy brain says that there's a little bit of trickery happening there, and I don't really know what's going on. So I'm just going to put that out there for you guys to think about. So at the end of the day, I do think that there is a chance E3 could be in trouble, and I'm not happy about it, but I think we need to look at it realistically and consider it. So if E3 goes away, you've heard my thoughts. I think it would suck, it would be bad for a while, but overall the industry would bounce back just fine, and maybe even replace E3 with a totally different show, or a couple of shows. I think that these are all options. So until we find out more information, this is what I think in the right here and now. What do you guys think? Are you upset about this? Are you not upset about this? Do you see this as dangerous for E3 going forward? Or do you think this is going to be just a tiny bump in the road and maybe nothing happens? Maybe E3 moves forward and everything's fine. I mean, I wish I spent more time actually talking about that on this video, but it's time for me to end this here. So maybe you think that. Whatever you think, talk about the E3 scandal below. And with that, this video is a wrap. Thanks, of course, as always, for tuning in, guys. This is Rob from Reliv2Review, and I'll catch you next time on another video.